Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Multiple Sclerosis Society of India's MS Education webinar series. We have been having a series of such webinars talking about different issues that people with MS, their caregivers, and their loved ones have been facing. This is the first time we are actually doing it on Google Meet. We had been in the past using Zoom, so please do bear with us on all the challenges that you're going to see, because sometimes people inadvertently will click on their present button and you'll see some other window. We would request you all to please not click the present button, because your screen will be visible to everyone. I know that there is a webinar fatigue setting in, but for us, this is an absolutely amazing and most interesting webinar, because for the first time, we are getting people who are in the policy, implementing policy makers on this show or on this webinar. And we are extremely thankful for all the busy panelists, especially extremely grateful to Mr. KVS Rao, Dr. Himanshu Das, and Dr. Das from NIRTAR for being here. I will quickly share with you what is the basic agenda. On the request of making this interactive, this is going to be a very different sort of a format. So what we are going to do is, I will share a little bit of presentation, a short presentation about multiple sclerosis. I will also share what exactly are the challenges, and we are trying to keep it very relevant to this panel and this topic, which is challenges faced by MS and RTWE Act. After that, we will hear Mr. Sitaram, who is one of our MS warriors, and the problems that he's been having and the challenges that he's been having, and in spite of that, how beautifully he continues to live life. Challenges are thrown his way, but that's become an everyday feature for him. We will also have Mr. Prasenjit Chakraborty, who actually is joining us as far away from Guwahati. He is a member of MSSI Kolkata. He's also an MS warrior. I will want you to listen to his recording. He won't be able to present and speak because it's difficult. He's completely bedridden and on the wheelchair, and he's taken a lot of effort. Then we will also have Dr. Netravati, who's associate professor at NIMHANS in Bangalore, and she will talk to us about the cost and the period of treatment, because some of you were asking for that information. She will also share her experience on how they assess a person with multiple sclerosis while issuing a certificate, or assessing as to what is the degree of disability or what is the condition. After these people have kind of shared their experience and spoken, we will open this up to the panelists, and I would request the panelists to then share their experience and what they feel after hearing the three speakers. And we will want you to speak a little bit about your experience and what you know and what you feel are the recommendations that Multiple Sclerosis Society of India should be giving or doing in order to work in collaboration with policymakers and the government and various other relevant agencies. Right after that, we will open this up for a question answer round. We have already received questions and we have categorized it. I will come to that when we reach the question answer session. I will now present. So for all our members who are joining us for the first time, you will be able to find a lot and almost all the information about multiple sclerosis on our website. So please visit and save this. You can take a screenshot of this slide and you can go back to it when the webinar is over. You can follow us on social media as well. Just to tell you a little bit, very briefly, Multiple Sclerosis was established in 1985. We are the only MS welfare organization in the world, in the country currently. We work through 8 offices and we are present in 7 cities. We are present in Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Indore, Kolkata, Mumbai and Pune. We are affiliated to the MS International Federation, which is based in UK, and they have close to 48 member countries, all working in the field of MS and research, as well as ways to work to better the life of MS people across the world. Really, what is our work? Again, it's very difficult to put together a whole list of what we have been doing for the last 35 years, but just to put it down in bullets, we are engaging actively with various ministries. We conduct doctor-patient interactions, medical seminars and camps. We provide services like counseling, caregiver sessions and scholarships. We are also providing home nursing care, physiotherapy, recreational activities, and yoga for our members, as well as their families and their loved ones. Now, if I was to quickly touch upon what happens when MS hits you, well, the only way to put it is that it's a multifold impact that touches different aspects of your life, your community, your workspace. We can categorize it under these 4 segments, which is physical. We do have physical impact, which could be visible as well as invisible. The invisible is putting a lot of challenges for an MS person, because visibly being disabled is one thing, but being invisibly disabled, and when nobody understands your disability, it becomes absolutely a Herculean task to break through and make people understand. We also have huge psychological issues, because one of the leading symptoms of MS is depression, which also then leads to isolation and then a complete breakdown of the will to live. We have social stigma. Most women have MS. And the reason for why more women have MS is not known, but anybody with a disability is viewed with stigma, and that also acts as a barrier to the quality of life. Finally, we also have a huge impact on our financial condition, because there is a loss of jobs. We are not able to continue with our work. As a result, the livelihood is impacted. We also have no insurance. The expenses of having a treatment or using DMTs is almost prohibitive. That is beginning to change a little bit. These are definitely the problems that we have. What we do? Well, again, just to put it very in a nutshell, we help improve the quality of life of our persons and our members who are associated with us. We also try to reach out to all those who are not in our fold, but we would be more than happy to welcome them into our fold and provide them with services. We advocate for the rights of persons with MS, especially more so ever since Multiple Sclerosis was included in the Rights of Persons with Disability Act of 2016. We are constantly raising awareness about MS, because it is still not known. It is considered a rare disease, but if you ask an MS person and the community that we work in, we are seeing huge increase in people coming with MS. And that could be also because of advanced diagnostics and access to more information. But it is unfortunately still very limited knowledge of MS exists amongst our stakeholders. This actually has prompted us to create a webinar and a platform such as this to connect our members, our stakeholders, policymakers, policy influencers, doctors, to bridge the gap. We want every one of you to know what we are going through, so that together we can make a better world for people living with MS and help improve the quality of life. The intention of the government, the intention of the schemes are there, but if it is not useful to the last person with MS on the ground, then really, does it make any sense? This is something which we have been reflecting upon, and that's the reason why we are having a series of webinars. And keeping the focus of today's discussion, just to put in bullets, the challenges at multiple levels, I have not gone into the depths of which level, what impact and what challenges we are having, but these are the different multi-level challenges we are experiencing as an organization, within the community that we live as an and as an individual. There is no central registry for persons with living with MS in India. So all the data that you see is either extrapolated or taken on some rationale. We are not sure because we don't have any incidence or prevalence data to show how many people have MS in the country. Our assessment guidelines, while it is there for everyone, it is not completely suitable. And we will share with you in this course why and how this is happening. Disabilities indicated in the government websites still are referring to 1995 Act, where only 7 disabilities are displayed. That is also a challenge. We are excluded in the employment reservations along with the other 4 disabilities. And we have also written to the Prime Minister, but we have not heard back anything yet. It's been more than 2 years. The other challenge is this is a high cost of disease-modifying treatment and therapies. There is a huge burden of disease. People are putting their homes on loans. They're putting their collaterals out there just so that they can afford the treatment. And that is something which is, again, posing a huge barrier to access to treatment and other rights of persons with MS under the Disabilities Act. And nothing that is happening yet in the field of rehabilitation, that seems to be a distant dream for us. We had all attended a very interesting webinar by Dr. Nirmal Surya, organized by our Mumbai chapter, where it has clearly been mentioned how important rehabilitation in MS is required. We have the panelists who are aware of the importance of rehabilitation. We'll share with you how a rehabilitation can help. So that was my presentation. I would like to announce right at the beginning that on request of the panelists, this is going to be a very different format. We will first hear from people with MS, what their challenges are, what they are facing. We have 2 people, Mr. Sitaram Bhatt from Bangalore, he's an MS warrior, and Mr. Prasenjit Chakravarti, who's from Guwahati, an MS warrior also belonging to the Kolkata chapter. So we will have Sitaram speak, and then I will introduce, after Prasenjit also speaks, I will introduce Dr. Netravati, who will speak, and then we will take it back to the panelists, and I will introduce the panelists as we go along. Sitaram, it's over to you.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. This is Sitaram Bhatt from Bangalore. I am around 48 years old. I am a chartered accountant with 20 years of post-qualification experience. Multiple sclerosis hit me around the year 2009. So it's been around 10, 11 years since I've been suffering from the disease. Initially, it started off with the imbalance problems, walking. People used to make fun of my walking, saying I'm walking like a drunkard person. So I didn't know ABCD of the disease. Initially, we thought it was due to some orthopedic problem in the backbone. And then we later on got to know it's a neurological condition. Finally diagnosed after 1.5 years, around 2011. The progression of the disease has been that initially I used to walk with the help of a stick, then moved on to crutches, then to walker, and presently I am wheelchair bound. The challenges, like Madam said initially, how to convince people about the invisible challenges. People are always looking at visible deformities, like in polio or some other diseases, which unfortunately we don't have. For all practical purposes, we look very fit and fine. Everybody gives us a second look as to why this person is on a wheelchair. So that is the first issue. I was in a good job in IBM as a consultant. As the disease took over, at that point in time, I had no physically challenged certificate. So as a consultant, I had to move around due to the job requirement. And so the company told me that since you are not able to move independently, go to the client's place like Mumbai, Delhi, or Calcutta and do the consulting. So they do not have a job opportunity in their company. So I was denied the opportunity to move to any other desk-based job. Since when I joined the company, I was physically fit. So they asked me to resign, go back, come back to IBM under the physically challenged quota as and when they come up with the inclusion recruitment policies. So I had to resign from IBM, and somewhere in 2013, I got the disability certificate, and with the help of that disability certificate, I got a job in a defense PSU in Bangalore. Although it was not matching my profile, I mean, it was not matching my experience levels, still I had to take it coming at the lowest grade because there was no other opportunity. And I couldn't leave, fend off my family without the finances. I couldn't afford to do that. So from a manager and senior manager of finance and accounts and financial consulting, I have come to that PSU in the level of a grade 2 officer. So that is the first challenge, a huge setback in my career, a career which was likely to take off and have a 2 decades of work. Suddenly crash landed, and I had to come and make a compromise in the present situation. 2013 is when I joined the PSU in Bangalore, an aviation PSU. But the challenges have been right from the day one. Initially, they didn't give me the work, saying that they are not clear as to what this disease is, and I had an issue with the because I had. Already had some vision problems. They said I had to get it corrected. Then they put me onto a board twice to get my health checked to see whether it was okay to take me on board. That was the initial phase. After that, getting into the job from 2013, the probationary period was for a period of 1 year. So by 2014, my job had to be confirmed as per their own HR standards and HR guidelines. But unfortunately, they kept on postponing for no rhyme or reason. They didn't give me any feedback as to what was the reason they were postponing my confirmation. It went on for 2 years. Then I finally had to write a complaint to the Commissioner of Disabilities in the year 2015, when I made my first complaint under the old act. The People with Disabilities Act. I made a complaint to the commissioner in Bangalore, which was forwarded to the commissioner in Delhi. However, there was no feedback and follow-up on that. I think they sent out a letter to my company saying that why this harassment is happening. So I was called and counseled and told that I cannot go out of the way. I cannot go without the proper channel, through routing through the proper channels. And I was counseled that I should not take this up in independent forums other than the official forum. That was one. After writing a letter along with this to the chairman, my services were confirmed in 2016. That is 2 years after the date when the services had to be normally confirmed. So that was the 2016 was the first time I complained. So 2016 was when I was finally given my letter of confirmation with the 1 year loss of seniority and 2 years loss of bonus and whatever financial accruements that I had to get. I lost 1 year of my seniority. All my juniors were promoted, are being promoted, and today I am in my 9th year of service in the PSU. I have not received even one promotion till date. They have kept me in the same position just because I have got multiple disabilities and I have asked for so many accommodations from the company. So that was the first phase of it. In 2016, I also had a relapse of my condition where I had an attack of optic neuritis on my left eye. It left me completely blind initially, and after treatment, I have recovered around 70 to 75% of the vision. So once again, these people, the company tells me that as I have been recruited, and the date of recruitment by disability or the so-called certificate of disability specifies that I am wheelchair bound and I am a locomotor disability, so I cannot take the advantage of multiple disabilities that come through in during the course of the employment. So my second disability, which relapse, which happened affecting my eye, and right now affecting my right hand, which is where I am losing coordination and strength in my right hand. So the office is going on telling me that no, these things cannot be considered. You have to perform signature and working on computer. I asked for reasonable accommodation that I cannot be doing, but they go on telling me that 30 signatures have to match, 40 signatures every day on the checks have to match, and the bank is constantly rejecting all my signatures, saying the signature mismatch. I have also been given an advisory saying that I'm working in a casual manner and I'm not up to the mark, and so I have to take more care in ensuring that my signature matches. I don't know how I will do that in my present condition. So these things I have gone and repeatedly I have gone and highlighted this to the entire top to bottom in my company, but nobody is taking it up seriously. So based on this, my second complaint under the new RPWD Act 2016, I have filed with the commissioner in Delhi in the year 2019, that is last year. So it's been a year and a half now since that complaint has been lodged with the commissioner, but nothing has come through from that. There was one letter which the commissioner sent out, which was a generic questionnaire to the company saying, do they maintain a roster of employees? How many employees are being given the facility of PWD jobs and under what classes and all that? For which the company has also replied in a casual manner, saying they are maintaining everything as per the requirements of the law. From that point to date, there has been no other further progress. Now, the recent problem that I'm facing is, now the manager has started abusing me. He has started calling me all sorts of unparliamentary language, using names such as Nalayak, Haramkor, and Nikamma, Baitke Kata Hai, and Natak Kata Hai. These are the words that I am facing on a daily basis, actually. I also made a complaint on this matter just to this month, to my third complaint to the PWD commissioner. I have already lodged it in Delhi, but I have not yet heard from him. It's been 20 days since. And this abuse continues till date, that, because my signature is mismatching, I'm not able to do work on the computers, and I have vision issues. There is a finite limit of files that I can look at in a day, because I have a fatigue problem and so many other invisible problems that madam talked about initially. These are not being considered by the company. I am being unnecessarily again and again told that I am not up to the mark. As a chartered accountant, this is not what we expect from you. You have to put more effort, you have to put in more deliverables, and whatever is expected from you, you have to deliver it. So there is no reasonable accommodation, which is mentioned in the RPWD Act. So these are things that are happening in my present condition. I have also, when I joined the PSU, there are lots of lacunae. There was no physically challenged toilet. There was no place where where we could access the training facilities. The auto was not being allowed inside. this being a defense PSU, it's a huge campus, and I cannot be expected to go on crutches or on a wheelchair because my workplace is 1 kilometer from the main gate. So I had to write letters, repeatedly write letters to the security, to the GM, to the management, to get them to work on this, allow my auto to leave me to the place of work, to the administrative building. I had to give me a western toilet and also ramp facilities, and conduct the training in the ground floor where it is accessible to a physically challenged person. But right, they have given me a ramp facility. Now the auto leaves me to the door of the administrative building, but still the toilet facility, I am not, it is usable. I can only go in. I cannot go out with the wheelchair because I can't close the door. It is not, it does the space. There is so much of space constraint that it is a one way traffic. I go in with the wheelchair in public view. I cannot close the door. And then if I have to come back, I have to come back in the same manner.
Okay. Training is, Sitaram, I think we're a little out of time, but
okay, let's finish it. Yeah. So training is, I'm finishing. Training is conducted on the first floor, which is around 30 steps, and they expect us to climb those steps. The other, they are comparing my disability with the disability of others who are polio afflicted, and they say, why, if they can climb, why can't you climb? Unfortunately, the other two officers are climbing, and they are, by birth, they are disabled and are used to this life. Well, unfortunately, I cannot do that. And so these three complaints I have already lodged with the commission. So there's nothing which has happened in spite of MS being a specified disease under the new act also.
Thank you, Mr. Sitaram. So the takeaway from this particular experience is, before the act and after the act, is there really a change in the life of a person with disability? That is something we need to all take a step back and hear and understand. We are going to play a very short video which has been made by Mr. Prasanjit Chakravarti. I'm going to share the screen because he has put audio and a short slide which is less than 4 minutes.
Hello.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Prasanjit Chakravarti from Guwahati. I am suffering from multiple sclerosis from March 2001. I am a professionally qualified computer programmer and was working in a reputed IT company. I had to quit my job of a programmer back in 2002 itself because I could not think deeply and concentrate hard, which are very essential parts of my job. Economic issues faced by PWDs like me. One, no income, as I am very severely disabled and can't work for my living, I have got very little economic options. It is often pretty hard to shell out rupees 10,000 or so, which usually is the price of the wheelchair, which has a very prominent role in my life. Simply put, without wheelchair, I'm bedridden. And one inch wheelchair usually lasts around 15 to 18 months. Two, to add to the above, monthly cost of medicines, diapers, dilaton catheters, etc., further add to my woes. Three, also to add the monthly fees of my caregiver, as I am completely dependent for activities of my daily living. Four, the situation is further aggravated in my particular case, as I have a younger sister who has got intellectual disability of 90%, and both of us are completely dependent on our mother, who is a 69-year-old pensioner. Five, aren't there any financial scheme, etc., which can help people like me? Medical issues. One, I would urge all the appropriate authorities to immediately revive the Swabalamban Health Insurance Scheme for person with disabilities, which was a boon for PWDs like me. Or two, make disabled multiple sclerosis patients eligible for the Niramaya health insurance scheme?
Yeah, I think President Ji did have a couple of recommendations which he put on another slide, and I don't have that, but he can always, we can send that presentation to you, Dr. Mr. Rao. We can send that to you. He's got the suggestions, and I'll try and pull that up towards the end of this program. He has given certain suggestions on what to do. I will now, so now you have heard about the two people with MS who are, what they are experiencing is a situation and a scenario before and after the RPWD Act. We now have, I now hand over to Dr. Netravati. Just a quick introduction, Dr. Netravati is Associate Professor in NIMHANS in Bangalore. She has a very keen interest and works on multiple sclerosis. She is looking and consulting many, providing consultation to many persons with MS. And what is even more heartening is that to have Dr. Netravati, she is a part of the Medical and Scientific Advisory Committee of Multiple Sclerosis Society of India. Mainly, the role of them is to get together, and they are going to be looking at the assessment guidelines, or they're going to share what their experience has been as to what assessment criteria they are using. We will also be talking to you all today on a very short conversation on the cost of treatment of MS, as well as the duration of the period of treatment. Over to you, Dr. Netravati.
Very good afternoon to everyone. Namaste, sir, Dr. Rao, sir. At the forefront, I am thankful to the MS Society for bringing up this issue, which is quite very important for a person, especially who is afflicted with multiple sclerosis. So there were three things which Madam wanted me to come. One was the assessment, and then the cost, and what are the problems we are facing. So assessment, what has happened is, multiple sclerosis is a neurological condition which comes under the category of multiple disabilities in the RPWD Act. So a patient may have either a vision impairment, or he may have locomotor problems, or there may be problems in balancing system, or even sometimes memory, like what Dr. Sitaram also told initially, that in concentration, Prasanjit also was telling about the concentration and the attention, what is required. So it is not just a one dimension which has to be covered. We have to cover the locomotor, we have to cover the vision, as well as the balance, as well as the mood disturbances which can happen only because of having multiple sclerosis. That will be irrespective of any other reasons. They can also have depression, they can also have some fatigue, which itself will be over the year because of having MS, that they will not be able to carry their activities even if they have a good power or a good strength in their limb muscles. So now in the RPWD Act, actually what has happened is they have divided the MS disability into two parts. One is for the locomotor, and they have also included the IDEA scale. Actually, that came up in 2016, which is a very good boon, which was not there in the previous Disability Act. Previously, it was only the locomotor motor which was being assessed. But eventually, even the IDEA scale came up, which is very good. But has it made a transformation into the patient's life? No. Now, for example, if a person has to put the IDEAs into disability, many people are not aware. First of all, many people are not aware that they should be including the IDEAs also to take in the cognition, to take the behavioral changes, the psychiatric component, the fatigue component, because the IDEA scale has four subcomponents where it can affect their quality of life, their activities of daily living, their education, their employment, all that. So many people are under the impression that if you have a psychiatric illness like a schizophrenia or a bipolar affective disorder, only then you should try to apply this IDEA scale. It may not be so. But I think that if we try to take each impairment, like whether the cognition is affecting any of these four skills, fatigue is affecting any of these skills, because many of our patients have a lot of hidden or lot of other non-vision impairment, like a patient has a weakness, a patient has difficulty in seeing, that everybody knows. But in a MS patient, they can have fatigue and pain, which only a doctor will be able to assess after asking properly. So if all this can be tried to relate in idea scale and try to put in idea scale and then try to do the disability assessment, I'm sure most of them will have the assessment above 40%. So this awareness of putting all the other hidden cognition, behavioral changes into the idea scale is not at all widely publicized in most of the people. Only few are aware of it, and who are aware, they do not know how to apply it. So that is one of the problems in disability assessment. And now coming to the cost, if we go, like there have been some companies which are there for more than 10 years, 15 years. So their medication starts only at 8,000 per month. And many of those medications can even go up to 30,000 or 50,000 per month, the best drugs. I'm just giving a rough estimate, especially in a financial, where in our institute, most of the patients get very subsidized amount of medication. So there I'm giving this cost. So the best company will give between 8,000 to 50,000 per month. Whereas the same thing is available as generics in last 9 to 12 months, which can come, not again, it is not very less. The generics also cost around 5 to 10,000 per month. But the problem with these generics is that the side effects are more and many people are not able to tolerate. And the efficacy, we are still not aware of the efficacy. So definitely the cost of the treatment is not something which is just it's going to cause a burden to the family. A family which is trying to actually, this MS usually affects people who are just in the marriageable age or just after marriage. So they are about to start their career and suddenly they have one big financial problems which has come into them. So it almost takes around 25 to 50% sometime of their financial for the cost of the medication. So this is about the aspect. And now, to ask about what are the other problems what we have in MS with persons with disability, I think we should have a composite scale. I think there should be a proper scale. Apart from this RPWD, how it should be done, I think the proper education has to happen. And just telling that this is coming under the disability, this is coming under the people with disability is not enough. I think there should be more awareness of education. That if a company just is going to announce that I'll take people with disabilities, they should also have provisions so that they will be able to accommodate such people and provide a very ergonomic, healthy lifestyle for them in their workplace. I think I urge the government people that we should not just see only which is visually seen, but also see the overall picture of an MS patient and try to see how much we can be helpful for these patients. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Netravati, for that insightful thoughts. Renuka, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Netravati. Indeed, this is exactly what we wanted you to cover, and you've done it so well. These are the challenges, really. And we are hearing from a doctor who's a neurologist, seeing MS persons. You have been able to share that. And so now what we are going to do, this is a request to Dr. Both the doctors on the panel and Mr. Rao. Is it okay if we kind of spill over for another 15 minutes? I think we are looking at spilling over. We are getting a lot of questions. Is that okay with you, or do we have to stick to that 5 o'clock? Clock out.
Yeah, 5:15 is okay.
Okay, great. So what we are going to do now is, this is one thing that the format that we are looking at, Mr. Rao, if we open it up with your comments, but before that, let me quickly introduce you and then we will go to Director Nirta.
Yeah, I think let's not waste time in introduction. And in fact, I want both the doctors of our ministry, Dr. Himanshu Das and Dr. S.V. Das, to first respond, and then I will respond.
Perfect. That's lovely. Thank you.
Good afternoon, respected Rao sir and Himanshu, our colleague, and all the Renuka ji and other members of the Multiple Sclerosis of India. Actually, this is an eye-opener for us. We see, I am an orthopedic surgeon. We deal in rehabilitation. Our institute also deals with locomotor disability. Honestly, we see very, very less number of patients of multiple sclerosis. They come for rehabilitation, very less number. And at least in this meeting, we could know the real problem. In undergraduate time, we know what are the problems of multiple sclerosis because it's, I understand it is like a diabetes. It affects all the systems of the body, from the vision, from the nerve, from the motor, from the sensory, everything. It can just a type of complicated diabetes, same like multiple sclerosis, all the problems. And there are psychological problems. There's so many things are there. Or neurology, I should not tell many things. But no doubt problems are many. What you told also about the assessment also, because that was there was a committee to look after the neurological assessment part. It has been created by the ministry. They have seen this assessment and everything has been done at that time in 16. At that time I was looking after the blood disorders. I have actually no idea. But anyhow, this idea and assessment must be a problem. They must be facing the assessment clinics where there is assessing the board. They must be facing problem. Because still there is a problem in many categories also. And no doubt multiple sclerosis area is again, it is confusing. And your ideas has been added. So how they'll assess. And they have to, what I understand, they have to assess all the systems, suppose a locomotor, vision, hearing, psychological, then same formula A by B, A plus B 90 minus A into 100, that is the calculation it goes on, and all the systems and ultimately value will come. I don't know how much it is coming, but what I find in case of Mr. Sitaram Bhatt, he must have at least minimum, because he is wheelchair bound, means he must have at least 70-80% he must have got, he should get from the locomotor category, right? At least we could know the problems, and we'll see whatever they are schemes, how it fits into it. We'll discuss with it. So we got the information from all of you. So Rao sir is there. We will see the what are the feedback you will get from it. We'll discuss in our level, and we'll try to sort it out. What are the issues we are facing, and how we can help you from the ministry side, as well as the how the assessment will be easier. That we'll try to sort it out in proper forms. That is only my opinion today. Thank you very much, sir.
Dr. Das, I want to know from you. What kind of rehabilitation intervention will help reduce the problem of the person with MS?
I think Dr. Neurologist is there. It is a progressive disease. It affects all the systems. Vision is affected. Hearing is affected. Psychological issues are there, like our intellectual disability category problem there, as well as the locomotor problem there. So no doubt,
no reversal is possible.
No, doctor, please tell Dr. Nerakavati.
Dr. Rao, actually, what happens is by the time, most of the time, the multiple sclerosis gets diagnosed, sometimes if there is a delay, there is going to be impairment or disability which will persist. It will not improve because this is affecting the nerves which cannot be reverted back. Only during the This goes actually through two phases. Initial phase, when they are going to have attacks of MS episodes, that time it can go back. But eventually, if the treatment is not taken properly, it can go into the progressive form. And it's almost like the medication has to be almost for lifelong, except in few conditions, almost it is lifelong. So it's a progressive disorder. So the progression is not just in locomotor, it's also in terms of the cognition, behavior, mood, And even it affects the bowel and bladder also.
So you are saying from our side, at most a walker or wheelchair is something which we can contribute from the rehabilitation side, and nothing and much, only medical treatment has to continue.
No, apart from that, I think many of these people, if we are able to give initially the disability and they are able to get into the employment at least, they will be able to at least support their families, because it's not that they're completely gone and they're completely wheelchair bound or they're on bed bound that they cannot work. Now what Dr. Sitaram, Mr. Sitaram Bhatt was telling, he is having difficulty in his legs, but he can still do most of the work. Like that we have one of my patients, I think she's in the panel, Kavita Jairam. She's having difficulty in walking, but she's so intellectually so good that she will be able to sit and do most of the work. So it is not just about providing them the support of the wheelchair, but also providing them support and some insurance schemes also, like what Mr. Prasenjit was telling, that can help them, the patient and their family.
Yeah, thank you. And Dr. Himanshu Das.
Namaskar, sir. Everyone, namaskar in the board and the participants. I had this good fortune of having to befriend some of the persons having multiple sclerosis. I think most of the points have been covered. Just to reiterate the same thing, sir, first thing is they are having problem with the disability certification. But the current formula of multiple disability actually doesn't directly apply to multiple sclerosis. Because when you have two disabilities or three disabilities, normally doctors are trained enough and doctors know how to calculate the percentage A plus B plus C or whatever it is. But in case of this multiple sclerosis, issue is they may have so many multiples of problems that most of the time their disability certification is an issue. And that is number one, sir. Number two, because of the medical load on the patient or on the family, that is so high, the amount of medicines and the amount of money that they have to spend, that itself is so high, so the families are not very much inclined towards or can afford to come to us for rehabilitative services of physiotherapy, occupational therapy, speech therapy, or clinical psychology, so on and so forth. The third thing is that most of them actually need some kind of psychological support, some kind of motivation that we are not able to give because they are not reaching our CRCs or our centers, sir. That is the third element, sir. And the fourth part, the misconception that all multiple sclerosis conditions are same, they are all highly progressive and they will eventually become bedridden very soon. This kind of a concept with the employer and the service provider has led to a condition that they cannot retain a job or they cannot even get a job. So these are few issues which I came across, sir. And but I think, however, with whatever insurance policies or whatever schemes possible, if you can give them the medicines early as possible and ensure the medications is continued lifelong, and then probably our CRCs and National Institute can think of other support systems that could be given. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, sir.
Himanshu Das, I want to know whether there's any success case where you have handled properly in your institute, which brought some relief to a person.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The first thing that we tried to work on the psychological part, because a motivated mind, a motivated brain, or a person who wants to do something himself, a person who wants to sort of achieve something or come out of it, those kind of psychology, once you are able to push in, definitely the other therapy services like physiotherapy, occupational therapy, which are not much effective earlier, they had some kind of better impact with the psychotherapy going on. So psychotherapy, physiotherapy, occupational therapy, these three things can go on in a way, provided we are able to actually take care of the medical part. If the client is from a good family background and they do not have much of a headache with regard to their funding and with regard to medicines that they want, in that case we have found that therapies and our psychotherapies and physiotherapy, occupational therapy, they have done well. But most of the cases when the patient is actually highly depressed because of his finance and medical support that the person is not having, then we are not able to offer the physiotherapy, occupational therapy and psychotherapy.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. With the permission, now I would like to intervene. First of all, I would like to congratulate the association for holding this webinar. It's a very important topic, which many do not know. Even the we also, for us, it is something Mr. Himanshu Das already knew about it, but I and probably Dr. S.P. Das, we learned a lot with the presentation and also the problems that persons with MS are facing. It is true, as the first speaker said, that stigma is still there, and it is there with all other disabilities, and it is an ongoing process where we are trying to, the act clearly says that there should not be any discrimination, we should treat them properly, the right to equality is there. As Ms. Renuka said, I think as Dr. Fundiman said, that awareness is still very much required, and it is an ongoing process. We are working hard at the central level and state level, lots to be done. We have to sensitize all the stakeholders, including the private sector, public sector, and various other organizations. And I have noted the problems that they're facing in terms of loss of jobs and insensitivity that the employer is facing. And I wanted to know whether Sitaram, he is working in PSU, whether it is a state PSU or central PSU.
Central PSU, sir.
Central PSU, HAL.
Yeah, so rightly then you have applied for the commissioner in Delhi. Otherwise, I would have asked you to apply in Bangalore, the commissioner. So what you can do is through Renuka, you send a copy of the representation that you made to the chief commissioner Delhi. Then I will see why there is delay. Regarding regarding the high cost, I would like to say that the act is very much aware of these issues. Lot of disabilities, 21 disabilities which have been recognized, and it's I'm very happy to say that this very important disease, even though it is not a disability per se in terms of physical or sensory, still it has been included. That is a very big achievement, and the act recognizes that some of these 21 disabilities require a lot of attention. Therefore, there is a concept called high support needs in the act itself, and we have prepared guidelines for what should be called high support needs, how they should be measured, and the state government have to set up an assessment board, and once the application is received, a committee will look into the aspects of the person in terms of his socioeconomic environment, his disability extent, and what is the kind of financial assistance is required, what is the situation of the family. All these points are taken into account. In fact, I think Nimans also was part of this exercise. Dr. Jagdisha was part of this committee. In fact, he was part of the committee which had also decided the assessment guidelines for all the disabilities. So in case there is a problem that assessment is not proper, I would suggest that since Nimans is dealing with not only mental health but also neurosciences, if the director can have a committee and a committee of the professionals in your own institute and also somebody from other institutes and some NGOs and come up with some proper suggestion of assessment, then you write to us. Definitely we'll take up with the health ministry, because finally health ministry will have the final say, because that is a technical body. And if Nimans can make a suggestion that this is the way how assessment should be done, these are the practical problems that we are facing, definitely we'll take it forward. But the letter should come from the director Nimans to us, and then we'll take up with health ministry. And as regards the high cost is concerned, apart from in fact you can take up with the state governments regarding the high support need, because we already written to the state governments to set up another authority that not only the assessment board will take care, and after that the authority which they'll set up, that will provide certain financial and non-financial assistance. That should take care of the high support, high cost. And in addition to that, the suggestion that is made for Swalamban revival In fact, that was discontinued because the Ayushman Bharat had come. So you can see whether your issue can fit into the Ayushman Bharat. And as far as Niramaya under National Trust, you can also apply and see whether your this MS can be considered, because they have cerebral palsy, they have multiple disabilities. So if your application can be passed, probably you can avail Niramaya scheme. And the other issue is, in fact, the warriors, MS warriors, they have described the serious problems that they are facing. And in fact, Renuka said about central registry. I would say that we have the unique disability ID project, in which we are trying to capture the data of all the 21 disabilities. In fact, this at the end of the exercise, we will have the names and details of all the persons who are with disability. In fact, I have sent her two disability certificates in which the MS assessment was done. And from, I think one is from Chhattisgarh, another from other state. So far we have not received any complaint about the difficulty in assessment, but still, if there is a need for proper assessment, definitely the government will look into it. And as far as the jobs in private sector, all the there's no bar. It does not say that the private sector should include. In fact, in the government sector, out of 21 disabilities, only 15 disabilities are eligible for government jobs, and remaining 7 disabilities have been kept out of it, because even in the previous 95 Act, out of 7, 3 disabilities were entitled for jobs. So there is definitely some reason why the jobs were it was excluded for these 7 disabilities. But still, since the representation has been made, we are getting requests from many other disabilities also for inclusion. At the time when we would consider, we would definitely consider your case also. And I feel that in the private sector, that they can employ all the 21 disabilities. Though there is no kind of reservation, but there is no bar for employing all the disabilities. And I think with kind of awareness and sensitivity, they would be more able to provide reasonable accommodation. I think over a period of, because it is just a beginning and lots to be done by the central government and state government, I think in another 5 years we'll see that the employers will become more sensitive and more accommodative, and that is what we are hoping. And I'm sure things will definitely improve. And let me assure you, for the persons with MS, now that you are on the board of under the Act, definitely you can take shelter under it, and the governments will definitely work. And I would also suggest that you should also take up at your own level, the state level, and also with the health ministry, because there also it is more of the medical problem. We will definitely, from our side, we'll see how much we can do from the rehabilitation side in terms of psychological, then physiotherapy and OT, these matters. But please also take up with the health department, because the Act is not just implementation by our department. It is poses responsibility on all the departments. Like, for instance, when it comes to education, inclusive education, it has to be done by the education department. Health department. Sports department. So please take up very actively with the health department in your own state, and also in the central government health ministry. And I'm sure most of the issues, especially relating to high cost, definitely that over the period of another 3-4 years, I'm sure that the state governments and also the central government can come up with certain schemes which will help them, like other major disabilities, which will help them to ameliorate their cost aspects. Thank you very much. And if there are any questions, you can ask.
I request Renuka to moderate, because we have around 7 minutes, we can just take the most important questions. I know there are a lot of questions everybody is sending in, where we may not be able in a position to answer all the questions. What we are going to do is we're going to collect all these questions, and then we will collate it and we will take it up with the respective ministries. Renuka, over to you.
Thank you, Shankar. Thank you, Mr. Rao, Dr. Das, Dr. Himanshu. Yes, we in fact have already got many questions, and Mr. Rao, I have already forwarded those questions to you.
Let me add one important thing which I missed out.
Yeah.
Is that I think the question arises is after the new act, what is the benefit that the person with MS has got? So let me tell you, legally, it is very important that whatever the rights and entitlements are there in the act, are there also applicable to persons with multiple sclerosis. For instance, right to equality, right to non-discrimination, reasonable accommodation, legal capacity. Legal capacity means that persons to right to own property and other things, and guardianship. They are eligible for even guardianship. The parents are very old. If they think that the child has to have a safe life after them, then they are entitled for limited guardianship. Then skill development. Even there, if they people want some skills to improve, they are entitled for that. And social security schemes that are available for other disabilities to improve the standard of living, they stand covered along with the other remaining 20 disabilities, especially even the health care, rehabilitation. I would say, in fact, representation in our policy making bodies at central state level, where 10 members of the disabilities are to be represented, I am sure that your turn also will come. So I am sure that and more importantly, free education, age of 18 years, and reservation of students with disabilities of MS, 21 disabilities are covered at the higher education institution, 5%. So therefore, there are all these benefits which are there, but the only issue that I think haunts the persons with MS is the mainly the high support need and also the loss of jobs financially. I think these are things, definitely I'm sure solutions will be found.
Renuka, there are a lot of messages about the fact that many of them have applied for the disability certificate in their respective states and they have not got it. So I suppose that they'll have to pursue the matter with the local chapters, and we request the people to contact the chapters where we have a presence. Our offices will definitely help you. We have offices in Pune, Delhi, Hyderabad, Chennai, Indore, Kolkata, Delhi, in Bangalore, and all these places. So those of you who are in those cities, if you're having some difficulty getting the disability certificate, we request you to please contact the local chapters, and then we should be able to help you.
Not only local chapters, but all the, you can disturb the national institutes, our own national institutes, they'll definitely be able to help, because without the certificate, you cannot get any benefits from the government. So you must ensure that whoever is deserving should get, and try to ensure, take support from our national institutes and also from our composite regional centers, wherever they are. And in case there's no response, please, you can talk to the ministry.
Right. In fact, that's the exact pain point, Mr. Rao, that the disability certificate, whether it is employment, I'll give you two quick examples, like where we have received these cases from our members. So there is a person called Ruchi Sethi Gutch from Madhya Pradesh, and she was rejected the disability certificate by a government neurologist on the basis that she was not using any walking aid or that she was not in a wheelchair. And
each state has got a medical authority under a team headed by the medical superintendent of the district medical hospital. Going to a government neurologist will not be sufficient. They have to go to the district medical officer headed by the medical superintendent. The person should be the medical superintendent, not the individual neurologist. And in case they're not satisfied, they should make an appeal. There's an appellate authority also.
Right. This was actually a government hospital which was issuing the disability certificate. So But still, she can go for an appeal. That's one. The other aspect on this disability certificate, and when you mentioned the skill and livelihood, you know, even if you don't have a disability certificate and you have been, there is a case where a person has been offered a job, but when they asked him for a disability certificate, he said he doesn't have it. There is another case where this person had a disability of 80% and was offered a job, but then when you ask for the UDID, you have to submit your disability certificate, and that stays. That's one aspect. The third aspect is the UDID card of this person mentions that it is valid for, if the disability certificate is valid for 10 years. Now this disease is not going to go away in 10 years. It probably will stay where it is, but it might also progress. So in that case, again, to start this whole process of issuing or renewing the disability certificate, there have been many questions that have been asked by our members as to why do we have to get our disability certificate renewed when we are already in a, say, 80% state of disability. I mean, how? So there are no answers, but I have sent you those.
It is the job of the specialist to decide whether a person deserves a, should be classified under permanent disability or a temporary disability. But definitely we'll try to sensitize the health department to see to it that they take a decision properly.
Right. Okay.
So would it be possible, Mr. Rao, to have some kind of a joint workshop along with MSSI for all the health professionals on multiple sclerosis and the symptoms and some of the features of multiple sclerosis? Can we organize a joint awareness program for all the concerned doctors from across the country? Would that be possible?
Yeah, we will we'll talk about it separately. Definitely, there is definitely a scope for sensitization. I and Dr. S.P. Das and Dr. Imanchita will discuss on this issue and see how we can proceed on this.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir. Renuka, we have crossed the 5:15 mark, and I know we have a lot of questions. So I request you to please take a call about, how we close from here.
Thanks, Shankar. All the questions, I have already printed it out, collated them. I'm sure there'll be many more questions after listening to both the doctors and Mr. Rao on the panel. I would request all our members to continue sending the questions to your respective chapters, who can then forward it to us. We'll collate it, because the more information our policy implementers and the people who are custodians of this, the more information they have from us, the better are the chances of creating a more inclusive guideline assessment, and also making the entire process of issuance of disability certificates a little bit easy and not adding to the woes and challenges of an existing MS person and their family members. So I think that's pretty much what we need to do. Mr. Rao, I have already sent those questions. I'll forward it to you, Dr. Das and Dr. Himanshu. I will just send them over to you. It will give you a very good insight of the whole ecosystem or the whole spectrum within which the challenges are. Starting from 0 to 100, you will have a whole range. And I will be very happy. We have an advocacy working group which contains of a representation from every chapter. We'll be very happy to have a focus group discussion, and at any point of time, any inputs that is required from us, we will be able to collate a document and send it to you. But I think this is just the beginning, and we are so happy that we have at least got your attention. We do have your attention, considering that you know about multiple sclerosis, but I think we need to take it to the next level.
I have read all the questions. I think give me 2-3 days time, I will give my response and you can circulate to everybody.
Wonderful. That sounds very, very nice. It's very kind of you. And Dr. Das and Dr. Himanshu, I will forward it to you, because I do have some questions on rehabilitation for MS. It must start before the disability sets in. Let's not wait for rehabilitation to kick in when the disability has started setting in, because it can be done at three levels. We can definitely work together with you. And I will just request my colleague Shankar, who's been helping, to do a vote of thanks to all the panelists.
Yeah, one final point is that you can just make a survey and see in other countries how they're handling this issue, especially in terms of research on this issue, like what are the rehabilitation that steps they're taking, and also whether it is preventive, and also whether it can be something can be done at the very initial stage of the child's birth. All this, I think, will definitely help my department to see how we can intervene as early as possible.
Right, I will do that. I'll send you, we have some published papers, and I will also reach out to MS International Federation if they have anything on benchmarking or any success stories on rehabilitation in MS at whichever stage, and I have noted your points. We'll share that with you as well. I will now request Shankar, would you please kindly do the vote of thanks?
Sure, Renuka. I at the outset, I'd like to thank Sri KVS Rao, Dr. Shakti Prasad Das, and Professor Dr. Himanshu Das for their presence and for their guidance and for their support. Going further, I think we have established a good positive start to a long-lasting relationship. This is not the end. In fact, this is the beginning. So we are hoping that we, along with all our, MSSI be the face of all our MS persons and present before you. And what is it is that we don't want to be seen as a grievance channel, but more like a support channel, saying that how we can work with you to ensure that all the necessary, the education, awareness, and support can be provided to our MS persons. To ensure that we make a positive impact on their quality of life. I would also like to thank Dr. Netravati from NIMHANS, Prasanjit and Sitaram, our MS warriors, for presenting their views, which is kind of Prasanjit and Sitaram have been the face of all the MS warriors here. And of course, for all the MS persons and warriors who have been here to take part in large numbers. We had around 160 people at one point of time, which is a very good attendance here. And all the chapter representatives, chairperson, secretaries for communicating this message and collecting all the information from all the MS persons and sharing with us in advance. And of course, I would like to thank Arun Mohan, who has been our initiated this conversation with Sri KVS Rao. So thank you very much for initiating this, for making this happen. And thank you. Of course, we have to thank Dr. Pramod. Dr. Pankaj and the team who is there from Dr. Pankaj's team, who have been helping us to moderate this. They are not even visible. So big thanks to all of them for their support in helping us to use this Google.
Yeah, one last point is I would like to ask Dr. Himanshu Das and Dr. S.P. Das to tell Ms. Renuka, maybe after the meeting, what extra precautions the persons with MS should take during COVID.
Regarding this multiple sclerosis, no doubt it is an immunological problem. No doubt they should be more careful about in comparison with the general. Any adult, they should be more careful to infection, and they are also they are having other problems also. Same, suppose they use any type of aids like say tricycle, wheelchair, so naturally it should be clean perfectly. So if they have got some visual problem, naturally they have to be prepared. They have to touch also accordingly. The things are they should take proper care to touch the things and to avoid this COVID, because this is involves most of the systems like visual and locomotor problem. So naturally, they have to be careful about this to get the infection. So they have to be more careful compared to other normal persons.
Sure. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rao, sir.
Rao, sir, is muted. Dr. Rao, you're muted.
No, this is an eye-opener for us also. We could know directly the problems.
Yeah, Dr. Himanshu Das, tell how psychologically they should handle it.
Yes, sir. This is one area, sir, because depression and sort of poor mental health is very, very directly proportional to immunity, sir. So how we can group or regroup the persons with MS, how we can form small self-help group and help them support each other and bring them out of this poor mental health or depression kind of a status, that will definitely help them to recoup their immunity, sir.
Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for joining in, and stay strong, stay safe. We will all overcome the challenges we are facing right now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.